Hi there, you're watching the IT Taster channel. I'm John, and in this video, we're going to take a look at the CIA Triad, or Security Triad as it's sometimes referred to, coming up right after this. The CIA Triad, or Security Triad as it's sometimes referred to, is a model that represents the three core principles of information security. They are confidentiality, integrity, and availability. And they really set out the goals of information security, and also feature in a number of security certifications. So let's begin with the first CIA Triad principle, confidentiality. In terms of information security, confidentiality is all about protecting data from unauthorized access, ensuring only authorized individuals have access to the data and unauthorized individuals don't. But it's important to be clear about what is meant by authorized and unauthorized individuals. In the context of information security, we immediately think of attackers as unauthorized individuals, which of course they are. However, a legitimate employee within an organization can also be an unauthorized individual. For example, an organization may restrict its employees, other than members of the HR department, from being able to access company payroll data. Therefore, employees who are not members of the HR department are unauthorized individuals who are not permitted to access payroll data. So it's important to think of unauthorized individuals in a wider context and not just attackers. It's also important to keep in mind that confidentiality applies to data that is static, such as that stored on a hard disk, for example, as well as data that is being processed or on the move, such as an email communication. Now, there are a number of methods that are used to maintain confidentiality. One extremely good method is encryption, the use of cryptography. And I'll cover encryption in more depth in another video. But to give a very basic overview, if we take a look at the diagram below, encryption involves taking some data that is usually readable by humans called clear text. And in the example, I've used the words IT Taster channel. The text then goes through a special process known as an encryption algorithm. The encryption algorithm uses complex mathematical calculations and a secret key, known only to the sender, recipient, or both, to scramble the data. The end product is encrypted data that we can see on the right-hand side of the screen. Now, in order to access the data once encrypted, an individual must have the correct key to be able to decrypt the data and make it readable again. Encryption is able to maintain confidentiality of static data, such as that stored on hard disks, for example, as well as data on the move, like secure email, where messages are encrypted before sending and then decrypted at the other end by an authorized individual with a key. Encryption of Wi-Fi traffic is another example of maintaining confidentiality of data on the move. If you've ever set up your own Wi-Fi, you're likely to have chosen a WPA2 encryption algorithm and provided a long passphrase to create the key. Encryption also maintains confidentiality of data stored on mobile devices like laptops and removable storage devices like USB hard drives and memory sticks. These types of devices are much easier for individuals to lose. There are plenty of documented cases in the press where a laptop belonging to someone important has been left on a train or stolen from a vehicle. However, if the data is encrypted, unauthorized individuals are unable to access the data. Access controls are another method used to maintain confidentiality. Access controls enable authorized individuals to access data, while preventing unauthorized individuals from accessing the data. It's typically a three-stage process, which involves an individual, a network user in this example, presenting an identity, a digital representation of a real-world individual. The identity must be verified using a process known as authentication. In this example, the user supplies a password. The password is checked against a secret stored password for that user, and if correct, the user is successfully authenticated. Once authenticated, the user is then authorized and assigned permissions or rights to access resources such as data. Now, some access control systems also include auditing of successful and failed authentication attempts. Steganography is another technique that can be used to maintain confidentiality. Steganography involves hiding messages within other messages, or in more modern IT terms, it refers more to hiding data within data. Now, in this very basic example of hiding data within data, the text in the boxes below doesn't reveal much, but on closer inspection, we can see ittaster is hidden within the text. Now, there are, of course, much more sophisticated methods available. For example, data can be hidden within the data bits that make up a digital picture, for example. However, it's important not to confuse steganography and encryption that we talked about previously. Steganography merely conceals and hides data, whereas encryption converts the data itself into code form. The second CIA Triad security principle is integrity. Maintaining integrity is about ensuring that data hasn't been altered or changed by unauthorized individuals. We need to be able to trust the data. Now, maintaining integrity also includes data on the move. It's equally important to protect messages and communications from being changed by unauthorized individuals. Unauthorized alterations to data can include malware infection, and system faults can also make unauthorized alterations, for example, files that become corrupt. To help maintain integrity, a technique called hashing is often used. Hashing enables us to verify integrity by taking some data, such as a file or message, and running a complex mathematical algorithm against it to generate a value known as a hash value. Now, providing the file isn't altered, whenever a hashing algorithm is run against the file, the hash value remains the same. For example, software vendors often include the hash value with each file in their downloads page. When the file is downloaded, the user can also run the hashing algorithm and compare the value with the software vendor's hash value. If the two hash values are the same, the integrity of the file has not been lost, and therefore the file has not been altered. However, if the file is corrupted during the download, for example, the file will have altered, and therefore when the user runs the hashing algorithm against it, the hash value will be very different, and therefore the integrity of the file has been lost, and we know the file has been altered. Digital signatures are another technology used to maintain integrity, and they're often used in financial transactions and email messaging. A digital signature can be compared to a real-world individual's handwritten signature, in that the signature validates the identity of the individual. Digital signatures work using the same principle, but they use electronic means to accomplish the same task. A digital signature is created by using a combination of hashing, certificates, and keys. But we'll look at certificates and keys in another video. Now, in the example below, user 1 sends an email they have digitally signed to user 2. The digital signature not only identifies the sender of the email, it also contains a hash of the message itself. Therefore, if the message is tampered with, the hash value will not match at the other end, and therefore integrity has been lost. And also be aware that digital signatures also provide something called non-repudiation. This means that the sender of the email in the example cannot deny that they have sent the message. Message Authentication Code, or MAC, is another method that is used to maintain integrity. MACs work in a similar way to digital certificates. With MAC, however, the message and a key is processed by a MAC algorithm. This produces a MAC tag, which is verified at the other end, enabling the message authenticity and integrity to be verified. But it's important to be aware that the same key is used between the sender and recipient, and it must be agreed. This differs from digital certificates that use public and private keys. Therefore, MAC does not provide non-repudiation. The third CIA triad security principle is availability. Availability is about ensuring systems, data, and services are up and running and available when needed. Now, there are a number of factors that can cause loss of availability, which include things like faults and hardware breakdown, software bugs, deletion of data, whether that be accidental by human error, poor design and lack of scalability, placing too much load on systems and services, power failure, fires and natural disasters like floods, earthquakes and hurricanes. Hardware fault tolerance and redundancy is one of the methods used to help maintain availability. Hardware fault tolerance means a system is able to tolerate a critical fault, but continue to operate. This is achieved by using redundant hardware, extra hardware that is available to take over in the event of a failure. One example is RAID, a redundant array of independent disks. It's a technology used in many servers to provide disk fault tolerance. RAID involves combining disks to function like a single disk. RAID 1 and RAID 5, for example, can tolerate the loss of a single disk drive and continue to function. However, not all RAID types are fault tolerant. RAID 0 is an example. Now, servers may also include multiple network interface cards to enable network communication to continue should a network card fail. Redundant power supplies also maintain availability. Should a server, switch or router power supply fail, for example, a redundant power supply is able to keep the device operational. It's also possible to build in redundancy at a server level. A failover cluster is an example. Should a server fail, another server in the cluster is able to take over to provide the services and applications of the failed server. Virtualization also offers many benefits in terms of server redundancy. A virtual server can be easily backed up, restored, or moved to another host in the event of a physical hardware failure. Server load balancing is a technology that helps maintain availability by distributing network and application traffic across multiple servers, and typically involves a cluster of servers. Load balancing is particularly important to maintain the availability of services and applications in environments with high volumes of traffic. Patches and hotfixes play an important role when it comes to maintaining availability of operating systems, services, and software applications. Patches fix bugs, issues, and security vulnerabilities, as well as including improvements and enhancements. However, it's important to be aware that in some cases, patches can cause an issue. If there's a bug within the patch, for example, organizations often test patches offline before implementing them in a production environment. Being able to maintain the availability of an organization's data is one of the most important requirements. Backups are a vital part of disaster recovery. Data can be lost in a number of ways, including hardware failure, corruption, overwriting, and deletion, whether intentional or unintentional, and also attacks, of course. Organizations and individuals typically use backup to external disk storage, tape, or cloud, or a combination of these methods. Whichever backup method is adopted, it's important to take regular backups and test backups by restoring to an alternate location, for example, to check the integrity of the data. All IT systems throughout an organization rely on the availability of electricity. The mains power supply is, of course, extremely important. Computer hardware is vulnerable to power surges, spikes, and outages. Organizations are able to help maintain availability by using devices such as an uninterruptible power supply, or UPS for short. A UPS is a device that switches to its internal battery in the event of a mains power failure. This enables equipment like servers, switches, and routers, for example, to continue running for a limited period until mains power is restored. A managed UPS also includes management software that is able to shut down a server gracefully if the UPS battery charge is getting low and nearing depletion. But for more extended power backup requirements, generators are used. These are typically diesel powered and are often used in conjunction with UPS devices to enable the backup generator sufficient time to start up. Now, in addition to backup power, environmental controls such as air conditioning are essential to prevent equipment from overheating. Multiple servers in a rack, for example, can generate a considerable amount of heat, whilst fans in hardware devices such as servers or switches expel hot air. The ambient air temperature of the surrounding air needs to maintain a cool temperature. Humidity control is also important because if humidity drops too low, the risk of damage resulting from electrostatic shock increases. And finally, site redundancy is an important aspect to consider when it comes to availability. Having an alternate site enables an organization to restore business services and continue functioning in the event of a major disaster. For example, fires, flooding, earthquakes, and hurricanes. Now, there are typically three types of redundant sites. The first type of site is a hot site. A hot site should be able to be up and running in a very short period of time, usually a matter of hours. A hot site typically contains critical equipment like servers, network infrastructure, and telecoms, all of which must be kept up to date and in a state of readiness. Hot sites are the most expensive. At the other end of the scale is the cold site. A cold site takes much longer to get up and running. A cold site is typically a building or facility to relocate employees to and equipment in the event of a disaster. Equipment is typically procured or relocated and set up again from scratch. The third type of site is a warm site. A warm site sits somewhere between the hot site and the cold site. It's a compromise between the two. It offers some of the facilities of the hot site and does not take as long to be operational as a cold site. Well, that brings us to the end of the video, and hopefully you found it helpful and it's given you a better idea of what the CIA Triad is all about. Don't forget, please give the video a thumbs up if you did enjoy it and drop a comment below. And if you haven't already, please subscribe to the IT Taster channel and remember to hit the notification bell to receive notifications of any new content. I'm also around on Facebook and Twitter, and it's always good to hear from you there too. So as always, thank you very much for watching, and I'll see you next time.